Welcome to InsideTech, Information Security Technologies. I am Kiran Tirukovela, your mentor for computer forensics. Well, little about me. I'm Kiran Tirukovela, graduated in computer science with few certifications like MCSA expired, CCNA expired, CH expired. Of course, all my certifications like CHFI, CCSP, CCNP, CCNPSEC, CCSP, all expired, but I'm still alive to train you today. So I'm your mentor for computer forensics. Anyway, that was really funny. So what exactly computer forensics is? I'm CHFI professional and I did my course long back from BC Council University. So most of my course tutorials will be useful to pass your CHFI exam and other certifications exams by various training companies like EC Council has said. So let us go through the course module. Before that, what exactly is computer forensics, right? Computer forensic science is a department of forensic sciences that is related to extraction and gathering of evidence from digital equipment. Basically, computer forensics is used whenever some cybercrime happens and the attack when happened like computer facilitated and computer targeted. Okay, you understand computer facilitated by using of computers and computers targeted. Okay, on these two scenarios, seize the computers and extract the information, that is extraction of the information, and retrieving the evidence that is suitable to submit in the court of law, right? So what that is what exactly computer forensic science is, okay? So the process involves is identification of evidence, then the preservation. Basically, identification is actually extraction of the evidence from the seized devices, whether it is a computer, router, a mobile phone, everything, a digital equipment, basically we call is by using or by targeted, okay? You extract the information, then preserving it. Preservation is that includes actually transportation of the evidence from the incident place to your forensic laboratory, because sometimes loss of transmission of data may give adverse results and you cannot produce the evidence in the court of law. So the evidence that you gathered must be suitable to submit the court of law. And for that reason, preservation is also really important. Then comes recovering, that is actually recovering an analysis of the evidence from the subject that you have seized, okay? So this is primarily done in computer forensics, that is in your computer forensic laboratory. And all this process is done in a systematic way, a methodological manner that is actually written or followed by through some guidelines, and that involves actually tools and techniques, and you must be really a skilled professional to investigate a cyber crime case or to extract evidence from a device. Okay, so what exactly forensics is? Forensic is a word that actually it's a synonym related to courts or a court of law, but actually something that you present before forum. Actually, it is a Latin word, forensics, that means before the forum, something what you said or what you present in the forum, okay? That is what forensics is. Examples of forensic evidence. Computer forensics is widely used in criminal evidences. Let us take some examples. BT killer, Dennis Rader was convicted of serial killings, and he sent some floppy disk. Actually, using the metadata embedded in the floppy disk was helpful in solving this case, and thereby Rader was arrested. Similarly, you have some Joseph E. Duncan. You can pause this video and read this content. And another case was Sharon Laptoka. Hundreds of emails on Laptoka computers was helped to investigate her killing, and finally so-called the criminal was arrested using her emails. And finally, Dr. Conard Murphy, you can read about this. I have downloaded a file let me show you, it's somewhere on my desktop or a download section. Yeah, so you can, these are the recent examples of cybercrime and e-commerce frauds related to investigations in India. I have downloaded for Indian cases, but you can actually search in the internet, Google, the cybercrime examples. See, let us leave this thing, but let me show blackmailing. Investigation was done by Mumbai police related to some 2.5 crore fraud related to attacks, and the charges were under 292 section 392 420 related to IPC, Indian Penal Code of IT Act. Now we have IT Act 2008 Amendment Act. And Dubai-based NRI was lured by anonymous woman on the internet who was, after winning his confidence and love, started blackmailing him under the guise of first woman with whom NRI got befriended and committed suicide. So this was really worst. If you take down another case, a BPO employees, you can pause this video and read what exactly it is. It's something cheating of 7.2 lakhs, that is 0.7 million. Alright, and another case. So if you go to all these cyber defamation case, all these PPTs, you can see more than 15,000 credit card information. Credit cards were fraudly used for air booking through internet, and the total amount that was screwed was 117 crores. That is 1.7 billion rupees. Alright. Okay. And this was another that happens in my own province, or we call it state. Okay. So these are, then this is funny one. I love you warm. Right. And the damage was 22,000 crore rupees. 22,000. You will not believe it. So you can understand how severe cyber crimes are. And computer forensics is a really good track where you can get a really nice jobs, and heavy salaries will be paid if you become a digital forensic investigator or cyber crimes investigator, digital forensic expert. So let us go to the PowerPoint presentation. This is our last slide, so you can pause the videos and check out this slide. Let me close this slide and let us go to the PowerPoint presentation. Okay. So common scenarios where cyber crimes or forensic evidence is widely used. Okay, all these are related to computer crimes in general, like hacking email accounts. If you hack someone's email account, even someone has opened his email and left out for to drink some tea or coffee, you are charged for reading his mails, right? Or fake profiles in general. Nowadays, Facebook's social networking websites or Twitter's people create fake profiles of celebrities, and that is a crime. So where forensic evidence or cyber crimes comes into the place. And the another scenario is unauthorized access to networks, web servers, FTP servers, etc., where cyber crime or investigation takes vital role in investigating the case. Child pornography, corporate espionage, piracy is really now screwing this world. Okay. And the stealing credit card information. There are a lot of websites, to my knowledge, where credit card information is publicly disclosed. So this is one another major crime. Okay, tampering with computer source documents, publishing false digital signatures, and cyber stalking. Okay, cyber stalking is one other severe case where let's see in the course module. Okay. And the phishing is also, people do not know what exactly phishing is. It actually really looks like a genuine page, and people give their credentials, and later on, you know, what can you mess up? So these are the common scenarios, and there are many other scenarios where computer forensics and the digital evidence really comes into handy to solve the cybercrime case. Okay, and I'm personally, as a cybercrimes investigator, solved a few cases in India and Kenya. I'm fed up with this thing, but it really plays really important. Okay, so computer forensics investigation approach. The main phases are secure the system, subject system, okay, that is before when the incident occurred, from tampering during the operation, take a copy of hard drive and never ever investigate on the original document, okay. Take the image and investigate on it, produce the evidence in the court of law. That's phase number one. After seizing, then investigate the data, that's what I said, data setting from installed application programs, systems, registries, and whatever, and what are the vital places in the computer, whether it's a Windows system or Linux system, where to locate the evidence is really important. And that comes handy if you become a skilled forensic investigator. You must know where the evidence is located, in perspective or with reference to the incident and the crime related to it, okay. Then create a detailed report throughout the investigation, maintain case of chain of custody, and sometimes you must become a expert witness, that is you will be summoned to the court of law, and as a expert witness, you must be able to justify your findings, okay. So this is the syllabus: introduction to computer crimes and forensics, cyber laws, incidents, response, and forensic investigation process. We will look each chapter just after a few minutes. Then build your lab, role of a cyber forensic investigator, file systems, and catch on hard disk. Catch on digital equipment, Windows and Linux boot process, Windows forensics, Linux forensics, latest forensics tools, commercials and open sources, data acquisition and duplication methodology, chapter 12, and how to recover deleted files. Here recover is not mentioned, how to recover deleted files and partitions. Then comes image file forensics. Generally image file forensics gives lot of vital information. This is good chapter because you can hide information in images, okay, that is sent to your partner, and he can extract the information from the image. That's what actually some kind of steganography. And then comes 16 chapter number, password cracking tools and techniques. Then comes log file analysis. This plays vital role in investigating attacks like web servers or an attacks in a networks. Investigation log file, there is a great artifacts to produce in the court of law. Then comes a web investigating attack. If you have already undergone ethical hacking course, there are a wide range of web attacks like SQL injection, cross-site forgery, local file inclusions, tamper, accessing servers remotely, maintaining it. Then in that case, web attacks investigation, how to investigate them. Then comes router forensics, investigating email crimes, mobile forensics, becoming an expert witness, then review Windows command lines and Linux command line tools. Then comes case studies. Okay, let's quickly go through each chapter. Introduction to computer forensics and crimes. Okay, introduction to computer forensic sciences, the evolution of forensics, and what is computer forensics is. Forensics is computer forensics methodology, importance of computer forensics, evidence collection ways, that's methodologically how to collect the weight evidence, objectives and benefits of computer forensics. Then comes computer crimes and types of computer crimes, because you must know what are the crimes that happens on internet and with respect to the standalone computers, okay. Then forensic investigation steps, professional conduct and legal issues involved in handling cybercrime cases. Then comes chapter number 2, cyber laws. Here I will give deep introduction of cyber laws with respect to Indian cyber laws, US cyber laws, UK cyber laws, and also I will give you some resources where you can actually find cyber laws related to some other countries. Third, chapter number 3 is incident response and forensic investigation process. Here we'll go to investigation methodology, evaluation case plan, okay, evaluating the case and the case plan, and the warning banners you might be seeing in the pictures. Whenever a crime scene happens, like a murder or a bomb blast, you will see a yellow tape with do not cross. this is some kind of warning, and how to use them when a computer crime incident happens in corporate or in general. Okay, and also warning banners with respect to the access of applications or a service. Then the evidence collection and initiating the evidence, imaging and examination, how to image them and how to examine them. Then collection and preservation of the evidence, how to transport and preserve the evidence. I said a couple of minutes ago, you know, while transportation or while seizing the evidence, the data loss sometimes happens while the transmission. So to prevent these things, what are the steps and measures you must take? Then maintaining the chain of custody. Okay, how to maintain the chain of custody, because you know, investigation, cybercrime investigation and digital forensics analysis is a waterfall techniques, because everything is related to the previous step. So maintaining a chain of custody is really important. Say for example, you have created some you have extracted some information and produced in the court of law, but your client or a criminal may say this is false things, and you have to go to the reverse step again, do the same thing, then you have to follow the next step, and the next step your client may say some other reasons, and the court of law may say give some other explanation. So sometimes this really screws up to the investigator. So maintain the chain of custody is really, really important. Okay, and please do keep in mind that digital forensic analysis and cybercrime investigation is a waterfall methodology, which I will explain you later in the course basically. Okay, then incident response. You must understand what exactly an incident is, like what is a computer crime incident. Incident is then the response, and next comes first response procedure. What are the response procedures you must follow, and incident handling proceeds when an incident is occurred. So to know that, you must understand what exactly an incident is. Then form examples, right? Then build your lab. Okay, in this chapter I will demonstrate you how to build your lab when you are learning this course at home, like what are the hardware equipments if you are really can put up some budget from your pocket or from your dad's pocket, or you're from some sponsors, how to build up your lab at home, because it requires hardware equipment also. If not, what are the software requirements. Also will demonstrate what is the budget, depends upon your budget, how to design a corporate forensic laboratory. Okay, and the physical design of the lab. It's not actually physical design, what are the physical security measures maintaining a forensic laboratory, because you know, my girlfriend has committed some crime and I got the evidences which were sent to a forensic laboratory, but she can appoint some goons and send to the forensic laboratory to steal the evidence. So what are the physical requirements or security measures that a lab must have? Okay, then comes the role of cyber forensic investigation. This is a really small chapter, a theoretical one, but a really important chapter. This chapter demonstrates what a skill set must an investigator have, the skill set is a technical point of view, what skills you must have it. Say for example, some crime was happened and the computer was used to initiate the crime, and the computer has operating system which is Linux, say for example Ubuntu. So a cyber forensics expert who have good knowledge on handling Ubuntu, who have deep knowledge on file systems of Ubuntu, handling Ubuntu operating systems, command line tools, must investigate through this case. If someone who has good knowledge in Windows forensics but not in Linux, must not touch. So this all depends upon a skill set of an investigator. Then comes a code of conduct, your mannerism, your attitude, even sometimes your dress up sense really matters to show your as an investigator, to present yourself as an investigator. Okay, your mannerism, your attitude. So what are the skill set and the code of conduct, and how to behave with your colleagues, for other forensic investigator, how to maintain the secrecy related to a crime scene or a case, or how to share them, how to work with them in a team really matters when you're solving some cyber crime. All this comes into code of conduct. All this, I'm presenting you with my real-time experience, okay? Then comes file systems and cache on hard disk. Here we'll see what is a story, all about the storage media and hard disk, and some information about them, not some, a little bit deep. Cache on file system types, Windows file systems and the types, disk partitions, Windows file systems, Linux file systems, registry and the hype of the registry, okay. Then comes Linux file system, of course, which was said earlier. And chapter number 7 is catch on digital equipment. Digital equipment, which actually I said while building your lab, but here in this chapter number 7, I will tell you, give you all screenshots of all digital equipments and their importance, their operation, how to use them, okay? What is the importance and how to, what is the importance as a part of your investigation or analysis, okay? Then comes chapter number 8, which is Windows boot process and Linux boot process. You must know to build up your technical skills, okay? Then comes chapter number 9, which is Windows forensics. How to, investigate on a Windows systems, finding evidences on Windows computers. This is what I said, a skill set of a computer. You must know where exactly evidences are located, evidences can be found on Windows computers, and how to get a volatile evidence, because sometimes some information is really volatile information. When you switch off the computers, it may go off. So how to get them, and what is a slack file basically, and how information is stored in a slack file, and how to examine them. Then comes a file systems and registry examination. As said in the previous slide, what is registry and how to investigate registry to get some information, like somebody has installed a malware, and how to a keylogger, and how to get the information from a registry regarding that, because he may have uninstalled the keylogger later after his purpose was done. Okay, then what is a virtual memory and how to examine it, investigating internet traces and alternate data streams, that is ADS, that is hiding files in some other things, some other files. Okay, then comes Linux forensics, where we'll review about the Linux boot process, which was already covered. Then there comes Linux partitions, then file systems and tools that demonstrate Linux forensics. Okay, chapter number 11 is really important, which is data acquisition and duplication. Data acquisition is getting the data and duplicating them, that is the imaging part. As said at the beginning of this video tutorial, that never ever investigate on original subject, whether the subject is computer or any other thing. Take the image of the hard disk or the evidence, where the evidence is located, and investigate on it. Okay, you must understand what are your limitations as a skill set investigator also. So here we will learn importance of data acquisition and methodology, then tools that demonstrate, then comes data duplication methods and the tools that demonstrate how to duplicate the data or imaging things. Okay, then how to recover deleted files. Here the recover was missing when I was showing a slide, previous slides. Okay, how to recover deleted files. Sometimes you delete files intentionally or accidentally, files are deleted. How to recover them. Say for example, in a pornography, say you might have sent some porn images to your friend or a girlfriend basically, and you might be irritating her, creating some kind of headache or blackmailing her, okay, and you have later deleted those files from your hard disk and even email. So from your Windows, where, how to recover those files to provide evidence in the court of law that you have deleted, yes, these images that you sent to your girlfriend were actually existing on your machine. Okay, how to recover them, even partitions, how to recover the partitions, and the tools that demonstrate the recovery of files and partitions. Then comes image file forensics. Image file forensics deals with file formats. You might be knowing a few file formats like JPG or JPEG, but there are other file formats like PNG, GIF, okay, which we will see some other file, known file formats and unknown file formats of images. And image header analysis. Like every file has some image, whether it is an image file or a doc file or any other file. So we will see how to, you know, find the header of some file. Okay, in this case it's an image file, but header of a file, and reconstruct this file. Okay, right? Because you know some information. Say you have merged two files. One is image file and another is doc file. So you have two image headers. Sorry, two headers. One is image header and one is a doc header. So how to find them? How to reconstruct them? Then comes steganography and steg analysis, which are very interesting chapters. And we have separate chapter steganography and the tools demonstration. Then comes your steganography. Steganography is really, really interesting chapter. It is actually way of hiding your data. So let's go to the history of steganography and its introduction, types of steganography and its techniques, and what is exactly watermarking. Sometimes you see on your videos or any other document papers, you find the watermarkings, sometimes invisible watermarkings. Let's see how they are kept and how to investigate them when you have copied some content from your still some project of your friend, and you have released that project as your own, and before that he has done some watermarking. So that watermarking will be helpful to investigate this case further and sue you in the court of law. Okay, then we will then in the chapter number 15 I will this is very big chapter, latest forensic tools, where I will be demonstrating latest and existing old forensic tools related to the previous chapters and also related to the upcoming chapters. I will practically demonstrate each and every tool in this chapter. Okay, password cracking techniques. This is one another important chapter, because sometimes investigators have to crack the password of a operating system or an application to get some information. Okay, introduction to passwords, types of password crackers, password cracking tools and techniques, and the default passwords. For example, if you are using a router at your home which was hacked, and or at your office which was hacked, and what are the default databases of them. Okay, log file analysis. This is my favorite chapter. I'm good at analyzing log files, and this is really important chapter, and you must have very good knowledge in analyzing log files, because log file reveals a lot of information regarding the attacker. Okay, introduction to log files, types of log files, importance of log files, and log file analysis. Types of log files, where we will be covering like SMTP log files, HTTP log files, and other log files, and how to analyze each kind of log files, etc. Okay, and the logging mechanisms, like if you want to log some systems. Actually I use logging mechanism to trace criminals. I did it in KU also. Then the tools mechanism, tools demonstration. Okay, web investigation attacks. As said, if you have a good knowledge in ethical hacking subject, you might be knowing different kinds of attacks. If you see here beside me, you need to magnify your system. SQL injection, cross-site scripting, insecure data office references, cross-site request, forgery, failure to restrict. These are the kinds of web attacks that happens on websites and web servers, which give access to your web admin panels, websites admin panels, and thereby servers. So such attacks, how to investigate them? So the types of web attacks, as said earlier, and the importance of web logs in conducting in investigating such kinds of attacks, and web log analysis, and follow through the IP addresses, because log file analysis gives good information regarding the IP address and how to find trace them back. Then DNS poisoning investigation tools demonstration. Okay, then the chapter number 19 is router forensics. I don't know whether you have gone through the ethical hacking course. I'm really good at networks and networking concepts, and router forensics is also one of my favorite chapters. Okay, here I will be giving you introduction regarding to routers, basic router configuration. This is only to tell you how actually a routing table is, how network traffic is routed between the interfaces to other routers, or between you and your clients, or you and other traffic. So important routing commands, attacks, and what are the kinds of attacks on the routers, okay, like you potential hacker can actually change your router configuration, you know, and how to investigate them. So router log analysis and the tools demonstration. Okay, then investigating email crimes. Right now I somewhere in my desk I have such case, where it is, okay, somewhere it's on my desk. It's related to email crime. Right now that's I'm investigating. Tomorrow I need to move to Delhi to, you know, catch the criminal. We got his address. I may go, but personally police department persons are going with whom currently I'm working. Okay, how email works, what are the types of email crimes, understanding email headers, whether you are using Yahoo email or Gmail, any other mail, or you are using clients like Outlook in Windows or Evolution in Linux, how to get the headers and how to analyze them, trace the email attacks are part of these chapters, and webmail forensics also. Then comes your chapter number 25, mobile forensics. I think this is pretty interesting chapter to me. I don't know about you, but a really interesting chapter, mobile forensics, because mobile forensics gives a lot of information regarding the SMSs, you know, and I personally sometimes feel happy to read SMSs sent from the subject, because they contain some privacy information, because I need to read them as a forensic investigator also, because it is these potential evidence to produce in the court of law. Because say for example I have sent my girlfriend that I will kill you or I will not leave you, and some other forensic investigator has investigated my mobile and he has to read this SMS and it is not actually screwing his privacy, so that is really important and I feel really funny. So latest mobile bold technologies and mobile security concepts, how to unlock Android phones and Android mobile forensics, and how to unlock iPhones and iPhone forensics, okay, and the tools that assist in demonstration. Chapter number 22, becoming an expert witness. Expert witness is a professional who has deep or expert knowledge in subject, and he must have good technical knowledge. Okay, I repeat it, he must have such a technical knowledge that he must be able to justify your findings in the court of law. Okay, so that is what an expert witness is. So in this chapter I will demo train you how to become an expert witness, and let us review Windows command line tools. In the previous chapter, like latest forensics tools chapter, latest forensic tools, I may be covering mostly GUI tools, but here I will also review what all the Windows command line tools that assist in your forensic investigation or digital forensic analysis. Also similarly, chapter number 24, the same thing is done on a command line, a Linux command line tools. Okay, chapter number 25 will not be taught by me, it will be taught by another police personnel related to nearby law enforcement. He will be dealing with or taking class regarding real time cases, that how these cases were solved. Okay, we will be looking at nearly 5 to 7 cases, how those were solved. Okay, so this will be taught by Mr. So this is all about computer forensics subject. After going through this course, I'm sure that you can actually write your exam, CHF exam, I think code number 312/49, I guess. Okay, and other computer forensics related courses. Okay, so that's all about computer forensics in brief. If you want any other information, please visit our websites, insectex.com. Insects are bugs that you generally find in websites, but it is not insects, it's Insectex, information security technologies. And you can call this number to our counselors, they will be able to give you more information. Okay, so that's all in this course. Have a good day.